I hope everyone is having a good day. I'm going to talk about reactive journey from 3 to 0.2 second using Apollo GraphQL, Redis caching, and monitoring. My name is Eesh Tyagi. I recently shifted to Germany to work as a front-end engineer at Scalable Capital. So let me give some context about this talk. This is an actual implementation case study, which we did in a previous company, ClearTrip. ClearTrip is a travel aggregator. It collects the data from different service providers and puts it on single platform, mostly the data for flights and hotels and trains. So naturally, there are a number of REST APIs which a client calls and which degrades the network performance, especially for a mobile browser. Hence, we decided to go for a single endpoint for ClearTrip to remove the dependency of client on the REST API calls. Now, why was this decision taken? So we were migrating our old legacy mobile web app into PWA architecture in React ecosystem. So let's see what were the problems we faced during that migration. The page time to interactive for hotel listing page was around 3 seconds. As per web standards, most of the users will drop out if it is beyond 1,000 milliseconds. The page size was around 2 MB, especially because there was no pagination. The entire list of hotels were being dumped at the client side. Then there were similar APIs being called by across the different channels. Like the same three APIs were called by desktop, it was called by mobile app, as well as mobile web, which obviously was resulting in overfetching because most of the data is not needed by mobile web. Even if we had decided to maintain different APIs for different channels, it is an overhead on the API team. Our API was legacy in nature, and it was returning a lot of verbose data. So most of the manipulation was happening at the client side. And we had this classic N plus one problem, where to fetch certain data, we had to do multiple API calls, which were interdependent. So this was the old mobile web. If you can see at the bottom, the page size is around 1.1 MB, and it is taking around 6 seconds to load. And there is no pagination at this point. This is quite heavy for the mobile browser, especially in slow network.
Yeah.
Let's deep dive into the challenges. This is the old architecture, where each client do a multiple API call to the API server and gets the same amount of data. Since mobile browser doesn't need that much amount of data, it was resulting in overfetching. This is a sample response from our API server. As you can see, it is not very user readable, and it's hard to make changes in the API. It takes some time. And also, there was a lot of data manipulation happening at the client side. For example, if you want to filter out 5-star hotels in the mobile web, the entire data was getting filtered at the client side. So the solution we came up with is GraphQL with Apollo client and Apollo server. Now, client, instead of calling multiple API calls, will call a single endpoint. Now, this single endpoint will in turn call different REST APIs. Now, there's no manipulation happening at the client side. And each client will get exact amount of data, no more, no less. So this is a new architecture. As you can see, we have introduced GraphQL Apollo server layer. And each client will query this server layer to get exact amount of data. Now, this Apollo server in turn calls our API server and gets the data, dynamic and the static data, from different sources. Let's briefly talk about the implementation. Initially, we were using React client with Redux Saga to make multiple API calls. So this is from client to server. and we were using 3 API calls for static and dynamic data. Then we introduced this GraphQL layer, which is at the server level. Now, what is the advantage of introducing the server level is, now instead of making calls from client to server, multiple API calls from client to server, there's only one API call from client to server, which is a GraphQL. And GraphQL in turn is doing server to server level calls. Now, GraphQL and our API server was in the same VPC network. So when GraphQL makes API calls to our API server, there is minimum or zero latency and throughput. So we used Apollo client as a wrapper on React client, which in turn calls our Node.js Express application wrapped with Apollo server, which in turn calls the API layer. So let's talk about GraphQL server. We were using version 14.2. We decided to go with Node.js with Express application. It's technology agnostic. You can use any other application. Right now, in my current company, we are using GraphQL with Kotlin. So to make a GraphQL Apollo server, you just include your Apollo GraphQL dependencies, define your schema, and write your resolvers. It's as simple as that. So you write your simple Express application, and you have to add your Apollo dependencies. So since we were using Express, we had to use Apollo Server Express NPM package, which is a package which connects your Apollo server to the specific HTTP framework. In our case, it is Express. Then you create an instance of your Apollo server where you can pass your schema, you can pass your playground settings, and you can pass your context. Now, schema can be built using make executable schema, and you can pass your type definitions and resolvers. And so why context is used? Because suppose if you want to pass some headers or carry forward some headers from client to your API level, or if you want to introduce some headers from the GraphQL endpoint, you can use context. For example, we used locale as a header, which was passed or carry forwarded from client to the API level for language. Then the Apollo server has this apply middleware function where you pass your Express application as a parameter. OK, we all know what resolvers are. We had a talk in the first half by Shruti. So we had these 3 API calls, which I showed you in the previous slides. These resolvers, we call the API server and get the data. Now, this data was we were filtering and normalizing at the GraphQL server level, which previously was being done at the client side. And this data is derived, and it is made into user readable format and adhering to your type definition, and it is sent back to the client side. One of the major improvement we did for page load time and page size was to use pagination. Fortunately, we were able to use fetch more function given by Apollo. What fetch more function does is it will give you a limited number of results to your client, and you can give your configuration of how many results that you want after you start scrolling. Let's talk about monitoring. Why monitoring is important. For a small project, this setup was perfect. But as your application grows, you need to analyze certain parameters. For example, how your internal API calls are performing. How many times your internal API calls are giving 5.0x. This was the first level of monitoring we introduced. There's a NPM package, Axios debug log, which is an Axios interceptor. It will intercept all the API calls from your GraphQL to your API server. Let me show you a live demo for this. So I have a local setup for my GraphQL server, and I'm querying. So this is the API for autocomplete, where I'm searching for city Munich. So if you can see, it is giving you the amount of the what is the response time for that API. So this was a very basic debugging tool which we use for Apollo server. Further, we introduced a more enterprise tool to monitor our application. We used New Relic, which is a tool for real-time monitoring of your application. New Relic gives you a very beautiful dashboard of your error analytics. It helps you analyze certain parameters like CPU utilization, database utilization, response times. Also, it keeps tracks of your deployments, and it gives a beautiful feature of showing you when is the downtime over a period of time. We also had a live GraphQL Voyager, which is basically a visual representation of your entities of your GraphQL servers. Let me show you that. So this is the live version of our GraphQL server with all the entities, and you can see all the relationship between different entities. It is mentioned in this graph. Okay, let's talk about caching. We can introduce different types of caching at different levels. We had Apollo client caching at the client side. Then we had API caching. But we wanted to improve further our page load time and page size. So we had this idea, why not cache our static data into some cache mechanism and fetch the dynamic rates from the API. So the first option which we came up with is Apollo server in-memory cache. But that won't work out for us in a cluster load balancing architecture. So we went for Redis, which is a centralized distributed cache system, and it will keep all the Apollo server instances in sync with the cache. So this is the basic overflow. So we had this get hotels as a resolver function, which was calling two functions called get cache static hotel and get dynamic hotel. Now, the dynamic hotel data will always hit the API server, but the cache static hotel will first check for the key in the Redis. If there's a cache hit, then it will return the data from the Redis. Otherwise, it will go to the REST API server. It creates the key and saves the response against this key. We were creating this key based on base64 encode and with the parameters inputted by user. For example, city, state, country, and domain. There were two major use cases which improved because of this caching. As I already spoke about pagination, we use pagination along with React Virtualize at the client side. Now, how React Virtualize list works is it will load only that much, a particular set of result set into the DOM, and as you scroll down, it will destroy all those elements which are not in viewport, and the next result set is fetched again from the server. So now, because of the Redis caching, instead of fetching from the API level, it goes to the Redis, and since the key is already generated, we get the cached result. The second use case is when user refreshes. When the user refreshes the first time, that means the cache key has already been generated, and the data will come from the Redis cache. The next level of caching we did is automatic persisted queries. It helps in network, improving the network performance and faster time to interactive. So as your application grows, your query size also increases. If you see in your network tab, we send a big query string to our Apollo server. Luckily, Apollo gives us a way of giving a hash to our Apollo server instead of the big query string. Now, if this hash is present in our Apollo server will fetch the mapped query from that and execute that query and send back the data. But if the hash key is not present, it will come back to the client. Client will send the actual query, and it goes to the server. Server will first generate a hash key and execute the query and send back both of them to the client. So this helps in reducing the network payload and hence the page load time. The last important caching was CDN caching. So it's always advisable to place your server behind your CDN. CDN helps bring closer data to your client. So we, in ClearTrip, we used CloudFront as a CDN. This is an important feature given by Apollo. You can give some cache into your type definitions or your types and fields. For example, you can give cache control directive to your types, which will be used by your CDN to cache these fields or these type definitions. Let's see how this caching is working in live for ClearTrip. This is a query for searching in Goa for some particular dates. Let me change the dates. Just focus on the time taken by this query for the first time. It's almost 2.85 seconds. Now, since the Redis caching is implemented, the next request should be much faster. It's almost 441 milliseconds. So as the user is refreshing, this happens a lot. When the user is refreshing or it is scrolling down, the API, the Apollo server is not hitting the API level. It is hitting the cache and it is getting the data. So this is an actual performance impact parameters. We decrease the page size from 1.5 MB to 245 KB. The major parameter is pagination and also different levels of caching. The page load time decreased from 9 seconds to 3 seconds. And most importantly, we decreased the page time to interactive from 3 seconds to 0.2 seconds. Now we have a single endpoint for our PWA client. And client gets all the derived data. There is no data manipulation happening at the client level. This is the web page test result, where if you can see in the left-hand side, this was the old mobile web. The first byte time is really bad. And on the right-hand side, the first byte time has improved. And if you can see, the start render time is 3.8 seconds before. That reduced to 0.8 seconds. So what are the takeaways? There's no dependencies on API team anymore. The front-end team can work independently by mocking data in the GraphQL side, and GraphQL server can they can sync with the API team later on. It's scalable and reusable. We started using this GraphQL layer for mobile apps and desktop. And it is scalable because you can scale this Node.js application in different ways. Like for instance, we use Docker containers and Kubernetes to scale our Apollo server. This also helps in giving useful insights about your internal APIs so that developers can work on it. Then you can introduce different level of cachings, CDN, Redis, and APQ to improve your page load time and page size. That's it, folks. Thank you.
Recording was brought to you by Twilio. We allow you to integrate different means of communication such as video, chat, or SMS into your React applications. If you want to learn how you can send SMS directly from a React chat, check out this video on the right or go to our Twilio YouTube channel. And if you want to watch another React India talk, we picked one out just for you over here on the left. Thanks for watching.